Hello everyone, it's Jabbar here, and happy Black History Month. Last year, I posted this video about the amazing Ifa system of divination practiced by the Yoruba people, which is based on binary code. You can check it out at the end screen. So with that, I want to continue on this tradition of posting more amazing Black history during Black History Month. However, I want to take it a step further. As much as I am equally as grateful as I am impressed with civil rights leaders such as Martin Luther King Jr. and Rosa Parks, the sad truth is that our mistreatment, struggle, and subsequent freedom against white oppression seems to be the only highlight of our history or greatness taught to us here in the West. In reality, there is so much more to our history than that, and it stretches back much earlier than our time here in the United States. Just as white people learn about the greatness of other white people throughout history, even prior to the founding of the United States, all the way back to the deep European roots of Greece and Rome, I think it's important that Black people have the same luxury, and I feel like it is absolutely necessary in order for us to have appreciation for ourselves and our people. You can't fully and truly appreciate who you are without appreciating where you come from. So for the month of February, I'm going to be releasing a series of short videos describing several accomplishments, highlights, and just generally interesting facts about what was going on in Africa without the influence of Europeans, and without the need to just focus all of our attention on Egypt or Carthage either. This series will be unapologetically focused on sub-Saharan African civilization. Africa is a vector continent for numerous diseases that are deadly to humans. This makes sense considering it is the birthplace of mankind, and as such, animals, plants, and microbes alike that exist there today all do so in a manner as to compete with the apex predator that we know today as Homo sapiens. It is believed that this is why historically, Africa has had less mass extinctions in comparison to other continents, and why it has a wider array of endemic diseases and parasites that can affect human bodies. All creatures, big and small, had to compete with humans from even before our ape-like ancestors began walking on two legs. With that being said, Africans over time have developed numerous strategies to cope with the spread of diseases. These include strategic living arrangements, unique hygiene practices, as well as medicinal traditions, some of which are still in use to this day. The one that we're going to talk about today is smallpox inoculation. Smallpox inoculation was practiced in West Africa indigenously prior to influence from Western medicine. So, before we get ahead of ourselves, what is inoculation? Well, I could give you a basic idea, but I feel like Dr. Alex Dainis can do a much better job explaining it than I can.
Thanks, Jabari. Inoculation is an umbrella term for methods that allow you to build immunity against a disease without actually getting the disease itself. The earliest form of this was variolation, where pus or scabs from a person recently infected with smallpox were introduced into a healthy person, either by blowing them up the nose or by introducing them into a cut on the skin. This would typically give the person a less severe form of smallpox than naturally acquiring the disease, which would allow their immune system to learn to fight it to prevent them from getting a more severe form of the disease in the future. Today, we more commonly use vaccination as a form of inoculation. This is very similar in that it trains the immune system to learn how to fight the disease, but rather than using the live infectious virus, instead, vaccines often introduce something less infectious into the body. So this could be a dead or weakened form of the virus, it could be a similar but less harmful virus, or it could be just a small portion of the virus or the instructions for making just that small portion. Both variolation and vaccination have played hugely important roles in fighting disease over the years, but I'll let Jabari explain how the practice actually spread across the world.
Thank you for that, Dr. Dainis. If you want to see more highly detailed breakdowns of vaccines, genetics, and other very sciencey topics, you can check out her YouTube channel, which I'll leave a link to below and at the end screen. So, back to the history of smallpox. Smallpox has been present in Africa, Asia, and Europe since at least 400 BCE, but possibly as early as 10,000 BCE. Skin lesions resembling those of smallpox victims have been found on Egyptian mummies. It is not clear exactly where it started, but it is known to have reached North Africa by 600 CE at the very latest, and likely reached West Africa shortly thereafter via trans-Saharan trade caravans. By at least 1700, smallpox inoculation was being practiced in West Africa to combat smallpox, though it was likely practiced there much earlier, since it seems clear that it was a very well-established practice in the region. A 19th century account of an African woman states that, "They used to scratch your arm until the blood came, Then, they got the fluid from someone who had the smallpox and rubbed it in. It all swelled up, and you covered it until it healed. Some children used to die. While this may sound terrible, there are a few things to consider. Firstly, the immune system is significantly more effective against fighting off smallpox contracted through the skin rather than contracted through the respiratory system. Secondly, not all people can survive a disease, regardless if they are vaccinated or not. Though vaccines do have a high success rate, on some occasions, people will still die, just as the previous excerpt explained. And lastly, and most importantly, not only was this method imported to the United States from Africa, but it is actually still practiced to present day. In fact, I had the same procedure conducted on myself prior to a military deployment, albeit with more modern methods and sterile equipment. And by modern methods, I mean a multi-pronged needle stabbed in the same part of my arm over and over several times in a row. I wish I was exaggerating, but I'm not. And surprisingly, it wasn't as bad as it sounds. The worst part of it actually is the nasty blister followed by the scar that leaves afterwards. And as Dr. Alex Dainis explained before, modern vaccination differs from inoculation in that it uses a dead or weakened form of the virus instead of the live infectious virus itself. So moving backwards a bit, in the year 1721, a ship brought a crew laden with smallpox to the port in Boston. Needless to say, this infected crew spread the disease which ravaged the city. An African slave named Onesimus informed his master Cotton Mather about the process of inoculation, claiming that it was performed on him as a child and all of the other children. He even bore the scar on his arm as evidence of the procedure. Onesimus' original name is not known, nor is it known what part of Africa he came from. However, Cotton Mather would tell everyone that his slave was a Garamanti. It is doubtful that this was in reference to the ancient ethnic group of Rome's African province, as they'd have ceased to exist as a people group during this time. With that said, this is more than likely a corruption of the word Coromantee, a word used to denote slaves who were imported from Fort Coromantine in what is now modern-day Ghana. Typically, these slaves belonged to the Akan ethnic group and had a reputation for being very keen and rebellious. Onesimus claimed that once someone underwent inoculation, it would protect them from smallpox infection for life. Of course, the practice was met with intense criticism by the general white populace since the knowledge of it was acquired from people whom they perceived to be savages. However, a local doctor by the name of Zabdiel Boylston embraced the idea and even performed it on his own son. At the conclusion of the epidemic, a hefty 14% of Boston's total population died off from the smallpox disease, while those who were inoculated using the indigenous West African method only suffered a death toll of 2%. As a result, smallpox inoculation was adopted on a larger scale and became a well-established practice in the United States nearly a century prior to the more famous Dr. Edward Jenner, who developed a similar method in Europe, but using smallpox instead. And even he himself had been inoculated with a West African method at just the age of 8 years. Though the history books will usually give credit to Cotton Mather or Dr. Boylston, this West African medical innovation would go on to form the baseline of modern vaccination as we know it today. This is not the only medical accomplishment that indigenous African people were aware of in pre-colonial times, and in my opinion, not even the most impressive either. There are several others worth mentioning, and I will do just that in my next video. For sources, check out my website, linked below. If you'd like to support future projects, you can do so there as well, or by clicking the join button below, or by becoming a patron. I hope you all enjoyed the video, thanks for watching as usual, and always remember, we don't come from nothing.